Shabbat Shalom, everyone. I'll give you guys just a moment and then we will go ahead and pray. All right, let's go ahead and pray, guys.
Yahuah, thank you for allowing us to be gathered, to be able to delight and study your truth. Yahuah, I pray you open my viewers' spiritual eyes and ears. I pray you put it on their spirits how important this message is. And we thank your Son, Yahusha HaMashiach, who is perfect in every way. And I pray that your remnant be found worthy to be protected by his blood. And we pray for your salvation, Yahuah, for our deliverance from this wicked world. We wait upon you, Abba. In Yahusha's name we pray. Amen.
All right, Shabbat Shalom, brothers and sisters. Welcome to Torah Truth Fellowship of Yahusha. I am your host, Brianna, and this is part 8 of Isaiah's message for the Remnant series. So we took a little break last week to address the seal of the Shabbat, which Abba greatly pressed on my spirit to speak about. And this week, we'll actually be touching on that subject again in this study of Isaiah. And this week, we're covering Isaiah chapters 55 and 56, which discusses the compassion of Yahuah, salvation for foreigners, and Israel's irresponsible leaders. So also, you guys, don't forget to check out my Facebook group. You can keep up to date with me, and you can find others like yourself to fellowship with. So, all right, let's go ahead and get to it. Beginning in Isaiah chapter 55, lines 1 through 3, let's go ahead and read that. Isaiah 55, 1 through 3. Oh, everyone that thirsts, come ye to the waters, and he that has no money, come ye and buy and eat. Yea, come, buy wine and milk without money and without price. Wherefore do ye spend money for that which is not bread, and your labor for that which satisfies not? Hearken diligently unto me, and eat ye that which is good, and let your soul delight itself in fatness. Incline your ear, and come unto me, hear, and your soul shall live, and I will cut an everlasting covenant with you, even the sure mercies of David. Okay, line 1, let's read that again. Oh, everyone that thirsts, come ye to the waters, and he that has no money, come ye, buy and eat. Yea, come, buy wine and milk without money and without price. So, let's read something from the book of Joel really quick. Joel 3, lines 15 through 20. The sun and the moon shall be darkened, and the stars shall withdraw their shining. Yahuah shall also roar out of Sion, and utter his voice from Jerusalem, and the heavens and earth shall shake. But Yahuah will be the hope of his people, and the strength of the children of Yashar'el. So shall ye know that I am Yahuah Elohim, dwelling in Sion, my holy mountains. Then shall Jerusalem be holy, and there shall no strangers pass through her any more. And it shall come to pass that in that day, that the mountains shall drop down new wine, and the hills shall flow forth with milk, and all the rivers of Yehuda shall flow with waters, and a fountain shall come forth out of the house of Yahuah, and shall water the valley of Shittim. Mizraim shall be a desolation, and Edom shall be a desolate wilderness, for the violence against the children of Yehuda, because they have shed innocent blood in their land. But Yehuda shall dwell forever, and Yerushalayim from generation to generation. So, this is the second coming. When New Jerusalem descends from heaven, the earth will shake, and Yahuwah's people will know that it is Him who does these things. And we will be hopeful because we know what is coming, and that is salvation, brothers and sisters. Jerusalem shall be holy in that day, New Jerusalem, that is, not physical Jerusalem. And in that day, the mountains shall drop as new wine, and the hills shall flow forth with milk, and the rivers of Judah shall flow forth with water. Which answers what we saw in Isaiah. He's saying, come to the New Jerusalem, come to salvation. Why will you die? For what? Salvation is a free gift. It's not something that we must buy. It is given to us when we repent and come back to the Most High's ways. Isaiah 66, lines 11 through 12, that ye may suck and be satisfied with the breast of her consolations, that ye may milk out and be delighted with the abundance of her glory. For thus says Yahuwah, behold, I will extend peace to her like a river, and the glory of the other nations like a flowing stream. Then shall ye suck, and ye shall be borne upon her sides, and be dandled upon her knees. And we've read this verse here a couple of times though. This is also speaking about the New Jerusalem and the comfort that she will bring us. She will comfort us like a mother comforts her child. Peace will flow like a river and glory like a flowing stream, and we will reap all of these benefits if we hearken to his word. Jeremiah 31, lines 6 through 14. For there shall be a day that the Nazarene upon Mount Ephraim shall cry, Arise ye, and let us go up to Sion, unto El Yahuwah Eloheinu. For thus says Yahuwah, Sing with gladness for Yaakov, and shout among the chief of nations, publish ye, praise ye, and say, O Yahuwah, save your people, the remnant of Yashar'el. Behold, I will bring them from the north country, and gather them from the coasts of the earth, and with them the blind and the lame, the woman with child, and her that travails with child together, a great company shall return thither. They shall come with weeping, and with supplications will I lead them. I will cause them to walk by the rivers of waters in a straight way, wherein they shall not stumble. For I am a father to Yashar'el, and Ephraim is my firstborn. Hear the word of Yahuwah, O ye nations, and declare it in the isles afar off, and say, He that scattered Yashar'el will gather him and guard him, as a shepherd his flock. For Yahuwah has redeemed Yaakov and ransomed him from the hand of him that was stronger than he. Therefore they shall come and sing in the height of Sion, and shall flow together to the goodness of Yahuwah, for wheat and for wine and for oil, and for the young of the flock and of the herd. And their soul shall be as a watered garden, and they shall not sorrow any more at all. Then shall the virgin rejoice and dance, both young men and old together. For I will turn their mourning into joy, and will comfort them, and will make them rejoice for their sorrow. And I will satiate the soul of the priest with fatness, and my people shall be satisfied with my goodness, says Yahuwah. So it says, there shall be a day that the Nazarene, the watchmen of the covenant, those who are guarded from wrath and concealed, will be on top of Mount Ephraim and say, Arise, let us go to Sion to see El Yahuwah. So sing with gladness and shout among the nations the amazing reward and everlasting love and comfort that we will receive in the Messianic kingdom. We should be excited for this day, brothers and sisters, not scared. Don't fear, remember? It says, save your remnant, and behold, we see that Yahuwah begins regathering all the children from all the countries that they have been scattered to. It says, a great company will return thither. Could this be the multitude that John sees aside from the 144,000 in Revelation 7, line 9? Says, After this I beheld, and lo, a great multitude, which no man could number, of all nations and kindreds and people and tongues, stood before the throne and before the Lamb, clothed with white robes and palms in their hands. Could this possibly be talking about the same thing? This is definitely something that I am going to be studying and searching out more and praying to Yahuwah on. My next big study is going to be on the 144,000. But back to Jeremiah. It says that they will come with weeping and supplication, and Yahuwah will cause us to walk by the rivers of waters in a straight way, and we shall stumble no more. Yahuwah is our Father, our Abba, and Yashar'el, Jacob, the name of his covenant, is his firstborn. We are his children. Hear the word of Yahuwah and declare it. Even to the isles far off, we are called to be messengers, brothers and sisters. We are called to share the good news. Now you don't have to go all out and be like, oh, excuse me, I'm sorry, getting the hiccups or something. All right. Now, you don't have to go all out and be like on some social media platform or something. But just pray to the Most High and ask Him how He wishes for you to share His word. And He will show you the way. He will reveal it to you. He scattered His people, but He will regather us and tend to us as a shepherd tends to his flock. And we shall all come together and sing unto Yahuah, and our soul shall be as a watered garden, and we will sorrow no more. The virgin shall rejoice and dance. The clean in heart shall rejoice and dance. Remember, a couple of weeks ago, we talked about what a virgin means in a prophetic sense. A virgin in a prophetic sense means to be clean in heart. Yahuah will comfort us and will bring us great joy from our sorrows. And really quick, let's look at line 8 again of Jeremiah. Jeremiah 31:8 says, "Behold, I will bring them from the north country and gather them from the coast of the earth, and with them the blind and the lame, and the woman with child and her that travails with child together. A great company shall return thither." Now, I want to show you guys the Septuagint version of this verse. And the Septuagint is a little different as far as the chapters go. So in your regular Bible, in my Bible to the Sefer, it's Jeremiah 31:8. But in the Septuagint, it's actually Jeremiah 38:8. So, and it says, "Behold, I will bring them from the north and will gather them from the end of the earth to the feast of Passover, and the people shall beget a great multitude, and they shall return thither." So, the Feast of Passover, that's really interesting. There is definitely going to be something significant about the Passover and going to New Jerusalem, beginning our second Exodus journey to the new Promised Land. All right, Isaiah 55:2 says, "Wherefore do ye spend money for that which is not bread, and your labor for that which satisfies not? Hearken diligently unto me, and eat ye that which is good, and let your soul delight itself in fatness." So, it says, why do you spend your money on useless, vain things? Why do you buy these things that don't satisfy your soul, like alcohol, drugs, false doctrine in these days and times? Eat what is good, and let your soul delight itself in fatness. So, what is eating good and delighting in fatness, delighting your soul in fatness? The book of Proverbs much speaks about the word being food for us to eat and digest. About eating the word and that it's good, and about eating the word that is wicked. It talks about eating the word that is wicked too, and what happens to you. So let's look at a couple examples. Proverbs 18:8. "The words of a talebearer are as wounds, and they go down into the innermost part of the belly." And another, just a few lines down, Proverbs 18:20, "A man's belly shall be satisfied with the fruit of his mouth, and with the increase of his lips shall he be filled." So, what does this mean? Well, the answer is actually found in the beginning of chapter 18. Proverbs 18:4 says, "The words of a man's mouth are as deep waters, and the wellspring of wisdom as a flowing brook." The words of a man's mouth are as deep waters, dark, bottomless, a pit. But the wellspring of wisdom is as a flowing brook, living waters. The word is living water. Let's read Proverbs 18:21. It says, "Death and life are in the power of the tongue, and they that love it shall eat the fruit thereof." In Proverbs 19:15 through 16, "Slothfulness cast into a deep sleep, and an idle soul shall suffer hunger. He that guards the commandment guards his own soul, but he that despises his ways shall die." So being slow to fulfill your end of the bargain, being lukewarm, that will cast your spirit into a slumber. And souls that remain idle starve. They are starving for truth and fulfillment and peace. A lot of the people we see today that say that they are woke are actually couldn't be sleeping deeper. They aren't woke at all. they are sleeping children who look to everything to fill their souls except for the Creator. They look for signs and wonders, and they watch the sky and the stars, and they don't look to Yahuah to fill their soul. Yahuah is the only one who can do that, and the children still don't get it. He said that we are a stiff-necked people. He that guards the commandments guards his soul. Your soul will be filled. You will find peace and rest and joy. And we can compare this to something we read in the next chapter as well. Proverbs 20:13 says, "Love not sleep, lest you come to poverty. Open your eyes, and you shall be satisfied with bread." The word is the bread of life. Let's look at two things before we move forward. In Jeremiah 15:16 says, "Your words were found, and I did eat them. And your word was unto me the joy and rejoicing of my heart, for I am called by your name, O Yahuah Elohai Sabaoth." Jeremiah said he found the word and he ate it. He meditated on it and he digested it into his belly. It is written upon his heart and part of every fiber of his being. Let's look at something that Yahusha said really quick too in John 6:35. "And Yahusha said unto them, I am the bread of life. He that comes to me shall never hunger. He that believes on me shall never thirst." And John 6:51, this is where it gets really good. And John 6:51 says, Yahusha said this, "I am the living bread which came down from heaven. And if any man eat of this bread, he shall live forever. And the bread that I will give is my flesh, which I will give for the life of the world." Wow, is that not amazing? Yahusha said he is the living bread that came down from heaven. He is the living word, the word made flesh. And the man who eats of the bread of Yahusha, his word, which is his father's word, eats of the bread of life. Okay, finally on to line 3. Where was I? Isaiah 55, line 3. "Incline your ear and come unto me and hear, and your soul shall live, and I will cut an everlasting covenant with you, even the sure mercies of David." We see this talked about a lot, this everlasting covenant. Let's look at some other places we see the everlasting covenant mentioned. Genesis 9:16, "And the bow shall be in the cloud, and I will look upon it, that I may remember the everlasting covenant between Elohim and every living creature of all flesh that is upon the earth." And this was after the flood, when Yahuah set his rainbow in the sky, that he would never flood the earth again, as a sign. It was a sign of his covenant between his word and the entire earth. And then Genesis 17:7, "And I will establish my covenant between me and you and your seed after you and their generations for an everlasting covenant to be Elohim unto you and to your seed after you," when Yahuah renewed the covenant with Abraham. And then Genesis 17:13, "He that is born in your house and he that is bought with your money must need to be circumcised, and my covenant shall be in your flesh for an everlasting covenant." Now, when we talk about this, it is a circumcision of heart, but the circumcision of flesh is a further step in your obedience to Abba, but it is not more important than circumcising your heart. Genesis 17:19, "And Elohim said, Sarah, your woman, shall bear you a son indeed, and you shall call his name Yitzhak, and I will establish my covenant with him for an everlasting covenant, and with his seed after him." When Yahuah promised to Isaac that the covenant would be carried on through his seed. And Leviticus 24:8, "Every Shabbat he shall set it in order before Yahuah continually, to be taken from the children of Yashar'el by an everlasting covenant." And this is talking about how Aaron, Moses' brother, the high priest of the tabernacle, was supposed to take frankincense and sprinkle it upon some of the showbread and make a fire oblation to Yahuah. All right, and then in 2 Samuel 23:5, "Although my house be not so with Elohim, yet he has made with me an everlasting covenant, ordered in all things, and sure, for this For this is all my salvation and all my desire, although he make it not to grow. And let's look at something we'll be discussing in the weeks to come. Isaiah 61:8. For I, Yahuah, love judgment. I hate robbery for ascending smoke offering, and I will direct their work in truth, and I will cut an everlasting covenant with them. Yahuah loves judgment, his judgment. He hates robbery, and he will direct our works in his truth through his Ruach, and he will cut his everlasting covenant with us. Give me just a moment. All right. Jeremiah 32, lines 39 through 40. And I will give them one heart and one way, that they may fear me forever for the good of them and their children after me. And I will cut an everlasting covenant with them, that I will not turn away from them to do good, but I will put my fear in their hearts, that they shall not depart from me. And this is the covenant that Yahuah will cut with us on the day that he gathers us out of the countries he has driven us from and brings us back to his promised land, the new Jerusalem. We will be one heart, one spirit, one body under one king, the Messiah, Yahusha. And the next verse gives us further detail on that. Jeremiah 31, lines 33 through 34 says, Behold, the days come, says Yahuah, that I will cut a renewed covenant with the house of Yashar'el and with the house of Yehuda, not according to the covenant that I cut with their fathers in the day that I took them by the hand to bring them out of the land of Mitzrayim, which my covenant they broke, although I was a husband unto them, says Yahuah. But this shall be the covenant that I will cut with the house of Yashar'el. After those days, says Yahuah, I will put my Torah in their inward parts and write it in their hearts, and will be their Elohim, and they shall be my people, and they shall teach no more every man his neighbor and every man his brother, saying, Know Yahuah, for they shall all know me, from the least unto the greatest of them, says Yahuah, for I will forgive their iniquity, and I will remember their sin no more. All right, that took long enough. All right, let's get on to lines 4 through 6. Isaiah 55, lines 4 through 6 says, Behold, I have given him for a witness to the people, a leader and commander to the people. Behold, you shall call a nation that you know not, and nations that knew you not shall run unto you because of Yahuah Eloheika, and for the Holy One of Yashar'el, for he has glorified you. Seek ye Yahuah while he may be found. Call ye upon him while he is near. Line 4. Behold, I have given him for a witness to the people, a leader and commander to the people. This is speaking about Yahusha again. Yahuah gave his son as a witness to the people of how to walk out the Torah correctly and perfectly. He is our leader, our high priest, our king, a commander to his people. And if we love him, we'll guard his commandments. All right. Line 5, Isaiah 55, 5. Behold, you shall call a nation that you know not, and nations that knew not you shall run unto you because of Yahuah Eloheika, and for the Holy One of Yashar'el, for he has glorified you. Again, we are going to look at something that we'll be going over into more depth in the coming weeks, and that something is found in Isaiah 65, 1. It says, I am sought of them that asked not for me. I am found of them that sought me not. I said, Behold me unto a nation that was not called by my name. The children of the nations who have sought him with all their heart, mind, and spirit, those who are not native born to the house of Jacob, those who are grafted into the covenant. And I want to read a passage to you guys from 2nd Esdras, also known as the 4th book of Esdras. And this book was removed from your regular Bibles in the 1800s and moved to what they call the Apocrypha or the Deuterocanon. And if you're skeptical of the apocryphal books, listen to this passage I'm about to read and check out what I show you. 2 Esdras 1, lines 24 through 37. What shall I do unto you, O Yaakov? You, Yehuda, will not obey me. I will turn me to the other nations, and unto those I will give my name, and that they may guard my statutes. Seeing ye have forsaken me, I will forsake you also. When ye desire me to be gracious unto you, I shall have no mercy upon you. Whenever ye shall call upon me, I will not hear you. For ye have defiled your hands with blood, and your feet are swift to commit manslaughter. Ye have not, as it were, forsaken me, but your own selves, says Yahuah. Thus says El Shaddai Yahuah. Have I not prayed pray to you as a father his sons, as a mother her daughters, and a nurse her young babes, that ye would be my people, and I should be your Elohim, that ye would be my children, and I should be your father. I gathered you together, as a hen gathers her chickens under her wing. But now, what shall I do unto you? I will cast you out from my face. When he offer unto me, I will turn my face from you. For your solemn feast days, your new moons, and your circumcision have I forsaken. I sent unto you my servants, the prophets, whom ye have taken and slain, and torn their bodies in pieces, whose blood I will require of your hands, says Yahuah. Thus says El Shaddai Yahuah, your house is desolate, and I will cast you out as the wind does stubble, and your children shall not be fruitful, for they have despised my commandment, and dine on the thing that is evil before me. Your houses will I give to a people that shall come, which having not heard of me, yet shall believe me, to whom I have showed no signs, yet they shall do the things I command them, that they have seen no prophets, yet they shall call their sins to remembrance and acknowledge them. I take to witness the grave of the people to come, whose little ones rejoice in gladness, and though they have not seen me with bodily eyes, yet in Ruach they believe the thing that I say. So, this prophecy is speaking about a people to come in a future time. And that time is now, brothers and sisters. So many people are waking up. There was a mass reawakening in 2010, and there was another mass reawakening in 2020. A lot of brothers and sisters awoke around these times. We are the children that this prophecy is speaking about, in our children and grandchildren. Yahuah is telling the house of Yashar'el, I have forsaken you, and I am going to find myself a new people, people who will be obedient to me. I have forsaken your feast because you observe my feast and still burn incense to Baal or offer sacrifices to Baal, as if Yahuah can't see, which in the book of Job, they were actually trying to convince Job that that was a thing, that Yahuah doesn't see all things. If things are done in secret, or if the sky is cloudy, that he can't see through the clouds. So, anyways, Yahuah says to Yashar'el, he is going to find a new people. And this is a people who is yet to come. Now, this is the cool part that I want to show you, is our Messiah, Yahusha, can be found quoting from this passage. So in 2 Esdras chapter 1, line 30 says, I gather you together as a hen gathers her chickens under her wings, but now what shall I do unto you? Let's look at what Yahusha said in Luke 13:34. He said, O Yerushalim, Yerushalim, which kill the prophets and stone them that are sent unto you, how often would I have gathered your children together as a hen gathers her brood under her wings, and ye would not? And again in Matthew 23:37, O Yerushalim, Yerushalim, you that kill the prophets and stone them which are sent unto you, how often would I have gathered your children together, even as a hen gathers her chickens under her wings, and ye would not? So, the same thing is declared in both books, our Messiah quoting from the book of 2 Esdras. Only those who are learned in this book would know our Messiah is quoting it. But back then, they knew the book of 2 Esdras. Those who were wise knew what Yahusha was quoting here. All right, line 6. Isaiah 55:6, seek ye Yahuah while he may be found. Call ye upon him while he is near. I want to show you guys another prophecy that was set forth in Amos 8:11-12. Behold, the days come, says Adonai Yahuah, that I will send a famine in the land, not a famine of bread, nor a thirst for water, but of hearing the words of Yahuah. They shall wander from sea to sea, from north even to the east. They shall run to and fro and seek the word of Yahuah, and shall not find it. Yahuah will send a famine, but not of food, of his word. This happened thousands of years ago, and it's happening still today. There are so many who don't know our Abba, who don't know his word, who don't understand his word. Brothers and sisters were persecuted for having Bibles, for sharing the truth. Our church leaders removed so many books that contain so much truth and build on and further interpret the prophecies that are found in our regular 66 canon Bibles. Brothers and sisters, I highly recommend checking out the apocryphal books if you haven't. At the very least, I recommend checking out Enoch, 2 Esdras, and Sirach, which is also called Ecclesiasticus. All right, let's look at Daniel 12:4. Says, but you, O Daniel, shut up the words and seal the sefer, even to the time of the end. Many shall run to and fro, and the knowledge shall be increased. As I just spoke about, so many things have been concealed for right now, for this very time, in this very moment that we are in. You are called, brothers and sisters, by your name, by our Father in heaven, by Yahuah. He has called you to obtain his knowledge and wisdom, that you might learn his judgments and do them. What other time could knowledge be more increased than right now? With all the technology we have, with information being literally at our fingertips, this is the age of information, a time of enlightenment. Really quick before we move forward, I want to read Proverbs 1, line 24 through 33. Because I have called and ye refused, I have stretched out my hand and no man regarded, but ye have set at naught all my counsel and would none of my reproof. I will also laugh at your calamity. I will mock when your fear comes. When your fear comes as a desolation, and your destruction comes as a whirlwind, when distress and anguish comes upon you, they shall call upon me, but I will not answer. They shall seek me early, but they shall not find me. For they that hated knowledge and did not choose the fear of Yahuah. Yahuah called our fathers before us. He pleaded with them when they came out of Mitzrayim, and they wouldn't listen. They murmured against Yahuah and Moses and Aaron. And even after he gave them great signs and wonders, he poured out the plagues upon Pharaoh, and they were left unharmed. He parted the Red Sea for them to pass over to the other side. He made water come out of a rock. He made it rain bread, and they still wouldn't listen. He sent prophet after prophet, and they still wouldn't listen. Instead, they murdered them. So in their time of trouble, the great tribulation, Yahuah will laugh at their calamity. He will mock them and feel no sorrow for them. But he told them, as we read in 2 Esdras, that he was going to find a new people who had never seen his wonders, but still believed him, still obeyed his word. And brothers and sisters, that is us. We have never seen the wonders of our almighty Elohim. We have never seen him rain plagues. We've never seen him divide the sea or make it rain bread. But we believe his word to be the truth anyways. And we obey him anyways. So when people tell you that Yahuah isn't real because we can't see him, you just remember that. He revealed himself unto our fathers. They saw his mighty works, and they disobeyed him anyways. So is it really that important, or is the desire of your heart require that justification? Oh, crap. Hold on, guys. I went back. All right, we're on 2 lines 7 through 9. Isaiah 55, 7 through 9. Let the wicked forsake his way, and the unrighteous man his thoughts, and let him return unto El Yahuah, and he will have mercy upon him, and to our Elohim, for he will abundantly pardon. For my thoughts are not your thoughts, neither are your ways my ways, says Yahuah. For as the heavens are higher than the earth, so are my ways higher than your ways, and my thoughts higher than your thoughts. Line 7 says, let the wicked forsake his way, and the unrighteous man his thoughts, and let him return unto El Yahuah, and he will have mercy upon him, and to our Elohim, for he will abundantly pardon. Now let's read Ezekiel 3, lines 4 through 11. And he said unto me, son of Adam, go, get you out of the house of Yashar'el, and speak with my words unto them, for you are not sent to a people of a strange speech, nor of a hard language, but to the house of Yashar'el, not to many people of a strange speech and of a hard language, whose words you cannot understand. Surely, had I sent you to them, they would have hearkened unto you. But the house of Yashar'el will not hearken unto you, for they will not hearken unto me. For all the house of Yashar'el are impudent and hard-hearted. Behold, I have made your face strong against their faces, and your forehead strong against their foreheads. As an adamant harder than flint have I made your forehead. Fear them not, neither be dismayed at their looks, though they be a rebellious house. Moreover, he said unto me, son of Adam, all my words that I shall speak unto you, receive in your heart, and hear with your ears, and go, get you to them of the captivity unto the children of your people, and speak unto them, and tell them, thus says Adonai Yahuwah, whether they will hear or whether they will forbear. So Yahuwah was telling Ezekiel to go out and speak to the people of Yashar'el, and speak Yahuwah's words unto them. He said, you're not sent to a people of a strange speech or a hard language, but your own people, the people of Yashar'el. Yahuwah told Ezekiel, I've made your face strong against their face, and your forehead strong against their foreheads. Even though they mocked Ezekiel and didn't believe him and treated him horribly, he never faltered. He was a faithful servant of Yahuwah. And Yahuwah knew the people wouldn't listen to Ezekiel. And Ezekiel knew too, because Yahuwah told him as much. But Ezekiel went out and prophesied anyways, as Yahuwah commanded. Ezekiel 3, lines 17 through 21. Son of Adam, I have made you a watchman unto the house of Yashar'el. Therefore, hear the word of my mouth, and give them warning for me. When I say unto the wicked, you shall surely die, and you shall give him not warning, nor speak to warn the wicked from his wicked way to save his life, the same wicked man shall die in his iniquity, but his blood will require at your hand. Yet if you warn the wicked, and he turn not from his wickedness, nor from his wicked way, he shall die in his iniquity, but you have delivered your soul. Again, when a righteous man turns from his righteousness and commits iniquity, and I lay a stumbling block before him, he shall die, because you have not given him warning. He shall die in his sin, and his righteousness, which he has done, shall not be remembered, but his blood will I require at your hand. Nevertheless, if you warn the righteous man that the righteous sin not, and he does not sin, he shall surely live, because he is warned. Also, you have delivered your soul. So, it says Yahuwah has made us watchmen, not Tsarim, those who are guarding the covenant and watching for our Messiah's return. When Yahuwah says the penalty for living wickedly is death, we are to warn our brothers and sisters of this. We are called to warn our neighbors of what living in sin does. If we see a brother or sister transgressing the commandments, we are supposed to lovingly correct them of their error. So they may be made aware and repent. And if we do this, then we have delivered our soul, and the blood is on their own hands. But if we don't warn our brothers and sisters, then the blood is on our hands. If we see a brother or sister committing iniquity and we do not warn them of it, their blood is on our hands, which technically makes you a murderer. And murderers don't inherit the kingdom, you guys. So we must be wary of these things. Line 8, Isaiah 55, 8. For my thoughts are not your thoughts, neither are your ways my ways, says Yahuwah. Yahuwah's knowledge and wisdom, it's infinite. He knows the depths of the sea. He can count the stars in the sky. He knows the measurements of the earth. But us humans, our minds are limited. Though we obtain his wisdom from him, there is only so much the human mind can perceive. Yahuwah isn't going to teach us all of the secrets and wonders of heaven right now, while we are in corruptible flesh bodies. The last time that knowledge was shared was with the fallen watchers who ended up breeding the Nephilim, or Nephilim, whatever you want to call them, the giants. And they taught men all kinds of wickedness, how to forge weapons of war, abortions, astrology, sorcery, pharmakia, and then they started tampering with the DNA of animals too. They taught all kinds of wickedness. Let's read line 9 too. For as the heavens are higher than the earth, so are my ways higher than your ways, and my thoughts than your thoughts. Now again, we're going to read from the book of 2nd Esdras. 2nd Esdras 4, lines 1 through 11. And the angel that was sent unto me, whose name was Uriel, gave me an answer and said, your heart has gone too far in this world, and think you to comprehend the way of El Elyon? Then said I, yea, my Adonai, and he answered me and said, Then I said, yea, my Adonai, and he answered me and said, I am sent to show you three ways, and to set forth three similitudes before you, whereof, if you can declare me one, I will show you also the way that you desire to see, and I shall show you from whence the wicked heart comes. And I said, tell on, my Adonai, and he is talking to Uriel at this time. Then he said unto me, Go your way, weigh me the weight of fire, or measure me the blast of the wind, or call me again the day that is past. Then I answered and said, What man is able to do that you should ask such things of me? And he said unto me, If I should ask you how great dwellings are in the midst of the sea, or how many springs are in the beginning of the deep, or how many springs are above the expanse, or which are the outgoings of paradise, perchance you would say unto me, I never went down into the deep, nor as yet into Sheol, neither did I ever climb up into heaven. Nevertheless now have I asked you, but only of the Nevertheless now have I asked you, but only of the fire and wind, and of the day where though you have passed, and of the things from which you cannot be separated, and yet can you give me no answer of them? He said moreover unto me, Your own things, and such as are grown up with you, can you not know? How should your vessel then be able to comprehend the way of El Elyon, and the world being now outwardly corrupted, to understand the corruption that is evident in my sight? So the angel Uriel was talking to Ezra, saying, Your heart has gone too far in this world, Ezra, to think that you have the same wisdom as Yahuah. So Uriel tells him, Can you measure the depths of the sea, or tell me the weight of fire? Can you call me back the day that is past? And to which Ezra says, You know, no, I'm a man. I can't do these things. He was like, why would you ask me that? And Uriel tells him, you know, this world is so corrupt, and you know the things of your own knowledge, that you, things that you have grown up with, the things that the Pharisees taught, the things that you just generally gain in life as far as knowledge and wisdom, I guess, goes. Where was I? And he said, How then can you perceive the way of El Yahuah, his sheer wisdom, being subjected to a world so wicked? How can you truly perceive that? The answer is you can't. 1 Corinthians 1, lines 25 through 31. Because the foolishness of Elohim is wiser than men, and the weakness of Elohim is stronger than men. For see your calling, brethren, how that not many wise men after the flesh, not many mighty, not many noble are called, but Elohim has chosen the foolish of things to the world to confound the wise, and Elohim has chosen the weak things of the world to confound the things which are mighty, and the base things of the world, and the things which are despised has Elohim chosen, yea, and the things which are not to bring to naught nothing that are. That no flesh should glory in his presence. But of him are ye in Mashiach Yahusha, who of Elohim is made us unto wisdom and righteousness and sanctification and redemption, that according as it is written, he that glorifies, let him glory in Yahuah. So let's break this down, what Paul's saying here, because some take this out of context as Paul calling like Yahuah foolish or something. But he's not. He's saying that even if Yahuah was foolish, which he isn't, he's still wiser than any man. And if Yahuah was weak, which he isn't, he is still stronger than any man. Yahuah chooses the weak things of this world to confound the mighty. Look at Joseph. Joseph was young, and he was not very big when his brothers sold him for 20 pieces of silver. And look what Yahuah did for him. He was raised up in Pharaoh's house, and he commanded the city. He was second in line to Pharaoh. Look at David. David was about 10 years old when he slew Goliath. He was merely a child, and he slew a giant. And once he got older, after facing many trials, he became king. Give me just a second, guys. Okay, let's go on to lines 10 through 13, and then we are on to chapter 56, which is also pretty short like this one. Isaiah 55, 10 through 13. For the rain comes down and the snow from heaven and returns not thither, but waters the earth and makes it bring forth and bud, that it may give seed to the sower and bread to the eater. So shall my word be that goes forth out of my mouth. It shall not return unto me void, but it shall accomplish that which I please, and it shall prosper in the thing whereto I sent it. For ye shall go out with joy and be led forth with peace. The mountains and the hills shall break forth before you into singing, and their trees And all the trees of the field shall clap their hands. Instead of the thorn shall come up the fir tree, and instead of the briar shall come up the myrtle tree. And it shall be to Yahuah for a name, for an everlasting sign that shall not be cut off. Line 10. For the rain comes down, and the snow from heaven, and returns not thither, but waters the earth, and makes it bring forth bud, that it may give seed to the sower, and bread to the eater. Let's also read line 11, because what I'm going to read next pertains to both. And line 11 says, "So shall my word be that goes forth out of my mouth. It shall not return unto me void, but shall accomplish that which I please, and it shall not prosper, and it shall prosper in the thing whereto I sent it." As it rains and snows from heaven and waters the earth, so that it brings forth bud in its season, so will Yahuwah's word be. His testimony, his will shall be done. It will not return void unto him. And wherever he sends his word, whoever receives his word, his statutes and commandments, that thing shall prosper. Now I want to read to you guys the parable of the sower. Give me just a second. Which is found in Matthew 13, lines 1 through 23. The same day went Yahusha out of the house and sat by the seaside. A great multitudes were gathered together unto him, so that he went into a ship and sat, and the whole multitude stood on the shore. And he spoke many things unto them in parables, saying, "Behold, a sower went forth to sow, and when he sowed, some seeds fell by the way, and the fowls came and devoured them up. Some fell upon the stony places, where they had not much earth, and forthwith they sprung up, because they had no deepness of earth. And when the sun was up, they were scorched, and because they had not root, they withered away. And some fell among thorns, and the thorns sprung up and choked them. But others fell into good ground, and brought forth fruit, some 100-fold, some 60-fold, some 30-fold. Who has ears to hear, let him hear. And the Talmudim came, his disciples, and said unto him, Why speak you unto them in parables? He answered and said unto them, Because it is given unto you to know the mysteries of the kingdom of heaven, but to them it is not given. For whosoever has, to him shall be given, and he shall have more abundance. But whosoever has not, from him shall be taken away, even that he has. Therefore speak I to them in parables, because they seeing not, and hearing they hear not, neither do they understand. And in them is fulfilled the prophecy of Yeshayahu, Isaiah, which says, By hearing ye shall hear, and shall not understand, and seeing ye shall see, and shall not perceive. For this people's heart is waxed gross, and their eyes are dull of hearing, and their eyes have closed, lest at any time they should see with their eyes, and hear with their ears, and should understand with their heart, and should turn back, and I should heal them. But blessed are your eyes, for they see, and your ears, for they hear. For amen, I say unto you, that many prophets and righteous men have desired to see those things which ye see, and have not seen them, and to hear those things which ye hear, and have not heard them. Hear ye therefore the parable of the sower, when anyone hears the word of the kingdom, and understands it not, then comes the wicked one, and catches away that which is sown in his heart. This is he which is received by the seed of the wayside. But he that received the seed in the stony places, the same is he that hears the word, and immediately with joy receives it. Yet he has no root in himself, but endures for a while. For when tribulation or persecution arises because of the word, by and by he is offended. He also that receives seed among the thorns is he that hears the word, and the care of this world is he that hears the word and the care of this world and the deceitfulness of riches choke the word, and he becomes unfruitful. But he that received the seed into the good ground is he that hears the word and understands it, which also bears fruit and brings forth some 100-fold, some 60, some 30. So Yahusha is saying that hearing the word of the kingdom is like a sower that went out to sow his field, and on the way he dropped some seeds on the wayside, and the birds came and ate them. And then some fell upon the stony places, and they sprang up too soon, and the sun scorched them, and they shriveled up because they had no root. And then some fell upon the thorns, and when they sprang up, the thorns choked them, and they died. But some fell upon good ground and brought forth fruit. He says these people will fulfill the prophecy of Isaiah. The people who fell on the wayside are those who see and don't perceive, and hear and don't understand. Those fallen upon the stony places are those who immediately receive the word with a joyful heart. But at the first test of faith, the first trial or tribulation, your root begins to wither because it's not planted in good ground. And those who are among the thorns, they hear the word, but the cares of this world and the deceitfulness of riches choke the word, and they become unfruitful. But those planted on good ground hear the word and understand the word and will bear much fruit. And two things before we move forward. So, not to be confused with the Song of Solomon, which is found in your regular Bibles. This is from the Wisdom of Solomon, which is found in the Dead Sea Scrolls. Wisdom of Solomon 3, line 15. For glorious is the fruit of good labors, and the root of wisdom shall never fall away. And Wisdom of Solomon 4, lines 3 through 5. But the multiplying brood of the wicked shall not thrive, nor take deep rooting from bastards' lips, nor lay any foundation. For though they flourish in branches for a time, yet standing not last, they shall be shaken with the wind, and through the force of winds they shall be rooted out. The imperfect branches shall be broken off, and their fruit unprofitable, not ripe to eat, yea, meat for nothing. We will definitely be seeing this in these last days. These elite people who look like they have it all and live all lavish lives, it's all going to come crashing down on them, and nothing will be able to save them. The I'm not here for a long time before a good time mindset, that's going to get a lot of people killed. That mindset is dangerous. All right, now let's read line 12. Isaiah 51:12. For ye shall go out with joy, and be led forth with peace, and the mountains and hills shall break forth before you into singing, and all the trees of the field shall clap their hands. Now let's read Enoch 51:1. It says, in those days shall the earth deliver up from her womb, and Sheol deliver up from hers that which it has received, and destruction shall restore that which it owes. Let's get a better understanding of what this is saying here. And we find that understanding in Daniel 12, lines 1 through 2. And at that time shall Michael stand up, the great prince which stands before the children of your people. And it's talking about the angel, Michael, the archangel. And there shall be a time of trouble such as never was since there was a nation, even to that same time. And at that time your people shall be delivered, every one that shall be found written in the sephir. And many of them that sleep in the dust of the earth shall awake, some to everlasting life, and some to shame and everlasting contempt. And this is at the resurrection, on the last day. Some will awaken from their grave to everlasting life, and some shall awaken from their grave to everlasting contempt. Now let's read about that. Let's read the rest of that chapter in Enoch, and it's only 5 lines. So Enoch 51, lines 1 through 5, says, in those days shall the earth deliver up from her womb, and Sheol deliver up from hers that which it has received, and destruction shall restore that which it owes. He shall select the righteous and holy from among them, for the day of their Yeshua has approached. And in those days shall the elect one sit upon his throne, while every secret of intellectual wisdom shall proceed from his mouth. For Yahuwah Sevaoth has gifted and glorified him. And this is the part that I wanted to get to right here. It says, in those days the mountains shall leap like rams, and the hills shall leap like young sheep satiated with milk. And all shall become like angels in heaven. Their countenance shall be bright with joy. For in those days shall the elect one be exalted. The earth shall rejoice. The righteous shall inhabit it, and the elect one possess it. All right, on to line 13, and then we are on to chapter 56. Isaiah 55:13. Instead of the thorn shall come up the fir tree, and instead of the briar shall come up the myrtle tree. And it shall be to Yahuwah for a name, for an everlasting sign that shall not be cut off. So instead of a thorn, a painful, useless bush, a fir tree will come up. And instead of a briar, also a painful, useless vine, shall a myrtle tree come up, which is pretty. It shall be a sign to Yahuwah for his namesake, an everlasting sign, and these people shall not be cut off. Now let's read Ezekiel 28, line 24. It says, and there shall be no more a pricking briar unto the house of Yashar'el, nor any grieving thorn of all that are round about them, that despise them, and they shall know that I am Adonai Yahuwah. We also see this declared later in the book of Isaiah as well. Isaiah 61 line, oh, it's declared in the beginning. Oh no, Isaiah 61, line 3 and line 11. To appoint unto them that mourn in Sion, to give unto them beauty for ashes, the oil of joy for mourning, the garment of praise for the ruach of heaviness, that they might be called oaks of righteousness, for the planting of Yahuah, that he might be glorified. For as the earth brings forth her bud, and as the garden causes the things that are sown in it to spring forth, so Adonai Yahuah will cause righteousness and praise to spring forth before all the nations. So Yahuah will turn the ashes and desolation into beauty. He will give joy unto those who mourn and oil his word. And these people might be called oaks, which is a beautiful, large, sturdy tree. The earth brings forth her bud. The lady travails in labor. The children are being reborn. The things that are being sown are springing forth. And Yahuwah will cause his righteousness and praise to spring forth in all nations. So, and I also want to look at Psalms 1, lines 1 through 3. Blessed is the man that walks not in the counsel of the wicked, nor stands in the way of sinners, nor sits in the seat of the scornful. But his delight is in the Torah of Yahuwah, and in his Torah he meditates day and night. And he shall be like a tree planted by the rivers of water that brings forth fruit in his season. His leaf shall also shall not wither, and whatsoever he does shall prosper. Blessed is the man who doesn't walk in the counsel of the wicked, but whose delight is in the Torah of Yahuwah, and who meditates on the Torah day and night, the commandments. He shall be like a tree planted by a river that brings forth fruit in its season, and his leaf shall not wither, and whatever he does will prosper. We are referred to as trees a lot throughout Scripture. Let's look at Matthew 8:24. It says, and he looked up and said, I see men as trees. And this here is talking about Yahusha put his hands on a blind man, and he asked him what he saw, and the guy says to him, I see trees, I see men as trees, and they're walking around. And after that, Yahusha went on to restore his sight. We are referred to as trees a lot. Okay. Now we are getting into chapter 56, which is also pretty short. This chapter discusses the salvation that is found for foreigners and how Israel's leaders became irresponsible. So let's get to it with lines 1 through 3. Isaiah 56, 1 through 3. Thus says Yahuwah, guard ye judgment and do justice, for my Yeshua is near to come, and my righteousness to be revealed. Blessed is the man that does this, the son of Adam that lays hold on it, that guards the Shabbat from polluting it, and guards his hand from doing any evil. Neither let the son of the stranger that has joined himself to El Yahuwah speak, saying, Yahuwah has utterly separated me from his people. Neither let the eunuch say, behold, I am a dry tree. Line 1. Thus says Yahuwah, guard ye judgment and do justice, for my Yeshua is near to come, and my righteousness is to be revealed. Yahuwah said to guard his judgment and to do justice, because his salvation is near to come. His right arm, his righteousness, Yahusha, is near to being revealed again. This has all been prophesied to happen in the Torah. Let's look at Deuteronomy 30. It says, it shall come to pass, Deuteronomy 30, 1 through 3. Oh, no, this is the entire chapter of Deuteronomy. Oh, let's look at the entire chapter of Deuteronomy 30. It says, it shall come to pass when all these things are come upon you, the blessing and the curse, which I have set before you, and you shall call them to mind among all the nations whither Yahuwah Elohaika has driven you, and you shall return unto Yahuwah Elohaika, and shall obey his voice according to all that I command you this day, you and your children, with all your heart and with all your soul, that then Yahuwah Elohaika will turn your captivity and have compassion on you, and you will return, and you will return and gather you from all the nations whither Yahuwah Elohaika has scattered you. And if any of yours be driven out unto the uttermost parts of heaven, from thence will Yahuwah Elohaika gather you, and from thence will he fetch you, and Yahuwah Elohaika will bring you into the land which your fathers possessed, and you shall possess it, and he will do you good and multiply you above your fathers. And Yahuwah Elohaika will circumcise your heart and the heart of your seed to love Yahuwah Elohaika with all your heart and with all your soul, that you may live. And Yahuwah Elohaika will put all of these curses upon your enemies and on them that hate you, which persecuted you, and you shall return and obey the voice of Yahuah and do all his commandments, which I command you this day. And Yahuah Eloheika will make you plenteous in every work of your hand, and in the fruit of your body, and in the fruit of your cattle, and in the fruit of your land for good. For Yahuah will gather again, rejoice over you for good, as he rejoiced over your fathers. If you shall hearken unto the voice of Yahuah Eloheika, to guard his commandments and his statutes, which are written in the Sefer of the Torah, and if you turn to El Yahuah Eloheika with all your heart and with all your soul, for this commandment which I command you this day, it is not hidden from you, neither is it far off. It is not in heaven that you should say, who shall go up for us to heaven and bring it unto us, that we may hear it and do it? Neither is it beyond the sea that you should say, who shall go over the sea for us and bring it unto us, that we may hear it and do it? But the word is very nigh unto you, in your mouth and in your heart, that you may do it. See, I have set before you this day life and good, and death and evil. And in that I command you this day to love Yahuah Eloheika, to walk in his ways, and to guard his commandments, and his statutes, and his judgment, that you may live and multiply, and Yahuah Eloheika shall bless you in the land whither you go to possess it. But if your heart turn away, hold on guys, I just exited out of my message, oh no, hold on guys. Okay, where was I? Alright. In that I command you this day to love Yahuah Eloheika, to walk in his ways, and to guard his commandments and his statutes and judgments, that you may live and multiply. And Yahuah Eloheika shall bless you in the land whither you go to possess it. But if you turn your heart away so that you will not hear, but shall be drawn away, and worship other Elohim, and serve them, I denounce unto you this day, that you shall surely perish, and that you shall not prolong your days upon the land, whether you pass over the Jordan to go to possess it. I call the heavens and earth to record this day against you, that I have set before you life and death, blessing and cursing. Therefore, choose life, that both you and your seed may live, that you may love Yahuah Eloheika, and that you may obey his voice, and that you may cleave unto him, for he is your life, and the length of your days, that you may dwell in the land which Yahuah swore unto your fathers, to Abraham, to Yitzhak, and to Yaakov, to give them. So, this was all prophesied to happen, brothers and sisters. Yahuah set a blessing and a curse before us and gave us the free will to choose. He gave us the way to life and the way to death. Those who guard his commandments and lay them upon their hearts and do them, those will be blessed. Psalm says, blessed is the man that walks not in the counsel of the wicked, nor the scornful seat of the sitters, but his delight is in the Torah of Yahuah, and in his Torah he meditates day and night. And we read it earlier, but let's go ahead and read it again. Psalms 1, 1 through 3. Blessed is the man that walks not in the counsel of the wicked, nor stands in the way of the sinners, nor sits in the seat of the scornful, but his delight is in the Torah of Yahuah, and in his Torah he meditates day and night. And he shall be like a tree planted by the rivers of water, that brings forth fruit in his season. His leaf shall also not wither, and whatsoever he does shall prosper. All right, line 2. Isaiah 56:2. Blessed is the man that does this, and the son of Adam that lays hold on it, that guards the Shabbat from polluting it, and guards his hand from doing any evil. Let's look at blessed is the man who guards the Shabbat. Look at this. Blessed is the man who guards the Shabbat and guards his hand from doing any evil or polluting this day. We talked about this verse last week as well. And let's look at Revelation 22:14. It says, blessed are they that do his commandments, that they may have right to the tree of life and may enter in through the gates into the city. Blessed are they who do the commandments, that they might have the right to the tree of life and enter the gates of the New Jerusalem. Blessed are those who meditate in the Torah day and night. Doing the commandments is how we know the Father and the Son. 1 John 2, lines 3 through 4. And hereby we do know that we know him, if we guard his commandments. He that says, I know him, and guards not his commandments, is a liar, and the truth is not in him. We know him when we guard his commandments, and his commandments are not burdensome. He who says, I know him, and doesn't guard his commandments, and from the least to the greatest of them, is a liar, and the truth is not in him. When we break a commandment, even a small one, we may as well broke them all. Breaking one commandment is just as bad as breaking all of the commandments, because breaking a commandment and not repenting for it will lead you to break other commandments. Satan will take a hold of you. Jubilees 23, lines 12 through 19 and 26. And in those days, if a man live a jubilee in a half of years, they shall say regarding him, he lived long, and the greater part of his days are pain and sorrow and tribulation, and there is no peace, for calamity follows calamity, and wound on wound, and tribulation on tribulation, and evil report on evil report, and illness on illness, and all evil judgments such as these, one with another, illness and overthrow, and snow and frost and ice, and fever and chills, and torpor, which is a state of physical or mental inactivity, like being lethargic, famine and death and sword and captivity, and all kinds of calamities and pains. And all these shall come on an evil generation which transgressed on the earth. Their works are uncleanness and fornication and pollution and abominations. Then they shall say, the days of your forefathers were many, even unto 1,000 years, and were good. But behold, the days of our lives, if a man has lived many, are 80 years and 10. And if he is strong, 80 years. And those evil... 80 years, and those evil, and in that generation the sons shall convict their fathers and their elders of sin and the unrighteous, and of the words of their mouth, and great wickedness which they perpetrate, and concerning their forsaking the covenant which Yahuah made between them and him, that they should observe and do all his commandments and his ordinances and all his Torah, without departing either to the right hand or the left. For all have done evil, and every mouth speaks iniquity, and all their works are uncleanness and abomination, and all their ways are pollution and uncleanness and destruction. Behold, the earth shall be destroyed on account of all their works, and there shall be no seed of the vine and no oil, for their works are altogether faithless, and they shall all perish together, beasts and cattle and bird and all the fish of the sea, on account of the children of men. And they shall strive one with another, the young with the old with the young, the poor with the rich, the lowly with the great, the beggar with the prince, on account of the Torah and the covenant. And on account of the Torah and the covenant, they have forgotten commandment and covenant and feasts and months and Shabbats and jubilees and all judgments. And in those days the children shall begin to study the Torah and seek the commandments and return to the path of righteousness. So this is the fruits of the curse that Yahuah has set before us. And this is also speaking about how we went over earlier. Yahuah said he was going to give his word to a foreign people, a people who will hearken, a people who haven't seen my signs and wonders, but will believe in me and my commandments anyways. And in those days, the children will begin waking up and returning to the Torah and learning the commandments and diligently seeking Yahuah with all their heart, mind, and soul. The next we're going to read is in Enoch 99:10, or in the Sefer, it is Enoch 100:10. Now then, bring gifts of salutation to the rain, that not being withheld, it may descend upon you, and to the dew, if it has received from you gold and silver. But when the frost, snow, cold, and every snowy wind, and every suffering belonging to them fall upon you, in those days will you be utterly incapable of standing before them. So it seems like a lot of the wicked people in this world live really great lives, right? Like, they're comfortable, they're satisfied, they're safe, they're taken care of. But there is going to come a day very soon too, where all of this is going to come to an end. A day where they will suffer miserably, when the plagues are brought upon them their riches won't save them. Their lavish houses and things won't save them. They are forsaken, and they will be incapable of standing in that day. They will be brought to their knees in shame. Let's read what Jeremiah said. Jeremiah 6, lines 16 through 19 says, Thus says Yahuwah, Stand ye in the ways and see, and ask for the ancient paths. Where is the good way, and walk therein, and ye shall find rest for your souls? But they said, We will not walk therein. Also I set watchmen over you, saying, Hearken to the sound of the shofar. But they said, We will not hearken. Therefore,
Therefore hear, ye nations, and know, O assembly, what is among them. Hear, O earth, behold, I will bring evil upon this people, even the fruit of their thoughts, because they have not hearkened unto my words, nor my Torah, but rejected it. Stand in his way, and ask for the ancient paths, the ways of the old, the good way, and walk in it, and you will find rest for your soul. Amen and hallelujah. Praise Yah. He has set watchmen over us, which were his prophets and the apostles, and now us. We are the watchmen now. Where was I? Saying, hearken, but the people would not hearken. Therefore, he will bring evil upon this people who wouldn't listen, because they reject his Torah, his instructions for life, instructions that are good and right and just. His ways are so, so good, brothers and sisters. All right. Exodus 31:13. Speak also unto the children of Yashar'el, saying, truly my Shabbats ye shall guard, for it is a sign between me and you throughout your generations, that ye may know that I am Yahuah Mekodishkem. So, and that means Yahuah who sanctifies. Truly his Shabbats ye shall guard. The weekly Shabbat, along with the other Shabbats that are part of his feast days. It is a sign between Yahuah and us, his people, throughout the generations, so that we know that he is Yahuah Mekodishkim, which means, like I just said, Yahuah who sanctifies. And we're going to read something that we went over last week as well. We're going to go over it again this week. Jubilees 2:17-22. Says he finished all his work on the sixth day. All that is in the heavens and on the earth, and in the seas and in the abysses and in the light and in the darkness and in everything. And he gave us a great sign, the Shabbat, that we should work 6 days and guard the Shabbat on the seventh day from all work. And all the angels of the presence and all the angels of sanctification, these two great classes, he has bidden us to guard the Shabbat with him in heaven and on earth. And he said unto us, behold, I will separate unto myself a people from among all peoples, and these shall guard the Shabbat. And I will sanctify them unto myself as my people, and will bless them as I have sanctified the Shabbat, and do sanctify it unto myself. Even so I will bless them, and they shall be my people, and I will be their Elohim. And I have chosen the seed of Yaakov from amongst all that I have seen, and have written him down as my firstborn son, and have sanctified him unto myself forever and ever. And I will teach them the Shabbat, that they may guard the Shabbat thereon from all work. And thus he created therein a sign in accordance with which they should guard the Shabbat with us on the seventh day, to eat and drink and bless him who has created all things, as he is blessed and sanctified unto himself a peculiar people above all peoples, and that they should guard the Shabbat together with us. So we see here on the sixth day that Yahuah ended his works and all that he created, and on the seventh day he rested, and he gave his angels a great sign on that seventh day, the Shabbat. And that Yahuah decided that he would give his Shabbat to man. It is an honor to celebrate the Shabbat, brothers and sisters. Not only is it the day that Yahuah rested from creating all the heavens and earth, but we also get to honor this day with our heavenly Abba and all his host of angels. What an honor we get to guard this day with him, with them. All right, line 3. Isaiah 56:3. Neither let the son of the stranger that has joined himself unto El Yahuah speak, saying, Yahuah has utterly separated me from his people. And neither let the eunuch say, behold, I am a dry tree. Don't let the stranger who has found Yahuah say, surely he will cut me off from among his people. Or don't let the eunuch say, I am a dry tree. This is a good reference to the seed that was cast on the rock, and grew, but the sun shriveled it up, and it died because it didn't take root. Don't doubt Yahuah and his mighty power, you lukewarm people. Soften your hearts and receive the truth. Receive the living waters. All right, moving on to lines 4-6. Isaiah 56:4-6. For thus says Yahuah unto the eunuchs that guard my Shabbats,
and choose the things that please me, and take hold of my covenant. Even unto them I will give my house, and within my walls a place and a name better than of the sons and of daughter, than of the sons and of daughters. And I will give them an everlasting name that shall not be cut off. Also the sons of the stranger that joins himself to Yahuwah to serve him, and to guard and to love the name of Yahuwah, to be his servants, and everyone guards the Shabbat from polluting it and takes hold of my covenant. So, line 4. For thus says Yahuwah unto the eunuchs that guard my Shabbats and choose the things that please me and take hold of my covenant. Yahuwah has the power to bring anyone back into covenant with him. All you have to do is repent of your sins and return to his ways. Exodus 19:5. Now therefore, if you will obey my voice indeed and guard my covenant, then you shall be a peculiar treasure unto me above all people, for all the earth is mine. Yahuwah is very specific about the day we guard his Shabbat. Look at Exodus 31:15. 6 days may work be done, but in the seventh is the Shabbat of rest, holy to Yahuwah. Whosoever does any work in the Shabbat, he shall surely be put to death. 6 days shall your work be done. 6 days, not 7 or 8 days or 9 days. 6 days you are permitted to work, and the seventh day is the Shabbat. Those who are not guarding this very, very specific command are playing with their lives. And actually, either this week or the coming week after that, I'm going to be going even deeper into the subject of the Shabbat and its importance. Leviticus 26:15-17. And if you shall despise my statutes, or if your soul shall abhor my judgments, so that ye will not do all my commandments, but that ye break my covenant, I will also do this unto you. I will even appoint you over you terror, consumption, and the burning ague that shall consume the eyes and cause the sorrow of heart. And ye shall sow your seed in vain, for your enemies shall eat it. And I will set my face against you, that ye shall be slain before your enemies. They that hate you shall reign over you, and ye shall flee when none pursues you. Yahuwah will curse you for breaking his commandments and transgressing his Torah. And those are not my words, brothers and sisters. Those are Yahuwah's words. I am nothing but a messenger, a servant of Yahuwah, who speaks on what he instructs me to. Deuteronomy 13:4. Ye shall walk after Yahuwah Elohim and fear him, and guard his commandments, and obey his voice, and ye shall serve him, and cleave unto him. We shall walk after him, walk in his righteousness, and fear him, and guard his word, obey his voice. This is how we serve him. And once our soul truly gets a taste of his spirit, you are hooked. Your soul does cleave to him. You want more, and you never want to let go. Line 5. Isaiah 56:5. Even unto them will I give my house, and within my walls a place and a name better than of the sons and of daughters, and I will give them an everlasting name that shall not be cut off. To these people, the people who have guarded the word and upheld the commandments, they will be granted a place in Yahuwah's house, within his walls, and he will give them a new name, a better name, an everlasting name. And we shall never be cut off again. So for those of you who are unaware, maybe let's go ahead and establish our identity as Israel. And we do this often here on this channel because we never know when new brothers and sisters are joining us. So it's been a while since we talked about this, and it's important that we understand our identity as Israel. So let's go ahead and go over it real quick. Let's start with Isaiah 41:8. Says, but you, Yashar'el, are my servant, Yaakov, whom I have chosen, the seed of Abraham, my friend. It says, but you, Israel, are my servant, and Jacob, which is another name for Israel, they're synonymous. I have chosen Jacob, the seed of Abraham, my friend. Now, let's look at what Paul says in Galatians 3, lines 26 through 29. For ye are all the children of Elohim by faith in Mashiach Yahusha. For as many of you have been baptized into Mashiach, have put on Mashiach, there is neither Yahudi nor Yavani, there is neither Jew nor Greek, there is neither bond nor free, there is neither male nor female. For ye are all one in Yahusha HaMashiach. And if you belong to Mashiach, then ye are Abraham's seed and heirs according to the promise. So, When we come into covenant with Yahuah, when we put our trust in Messiah, Yahusha, to lead us back to Him and to baptize us with the Ruach HaKodesh, there is neither Jew nor Greek, bond nor free, male nor female. We are all one in our Messiah. We are His people. And that is the only thing that matters. If we belong to Yahusha, then we are Abraham's seed and heirs according to the promise. You are Israel, grafted in with the Kodeshim into the house of Elohim. Ephesians 2, lines 18 through 19. For through Him we both have access by one Ruach unto the Father. Now therefore ye are no more strangers and foreigners, but fellow citizens with the Kodeshim and of the household of Elohim. All right, line 6. Isaiah 55, 6. Also, the sons of the stranger that joins himself to Yahuah to serve Him and to love the name of Yahuah, to be His servants, everyone that guards the Shabbat from polluting it and takes hold of My covenant. All right. So, the sons of the stranger, they join themselves to Yahuah. Those who were not called His people are called His people, and they are, and He is their Elohim. They serve Him, and they love His name. Tell me again how His name isn't important. They love His name. Yahuah Elohai Sevaoth. Hallelujah. Let's read Psalms 113. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. O ye servants of Yahuah, hallelujah the name of Yahuah. Blessed be the name of Yahuah, from this time forth and forevermore, from the rising of the sun unto the going down of the same. Yahuah's name is to be praised. Yahuah is high above all nations. Where was I? In His glory above the heavens. Who is like unto Yahuah Eloheinu? Who dwells on high? Who humbles Himself to behold the things that are in heaven and in the earth? He raises up the poor out of the dust and lifts the needy out of the dunghill, that He may set him with princes, even with the prince of His people. He makes the barren woman to keep house and to be a joyful mother of children. Hallelujah. And hallelujah means praise Yah. So this says, praise Yah, praise, O servants of Yahuah, praise the name of Yahuah. Blessed be Yahuah's name forevermore. From sunrise to sunset, praise His name. His name is high above all nations, and His glory above the heavens and the earth. He raises up the poor and the needy, the meek and ruach. Then He makes the barren woman fruitful to be a joyful mother. Praise Yahuah. Hallelujah. Ezekiel 20, lines 33 through 38 says, As I live, says Adonai Yahuah, surely with a mighty hand and with a stretched out arm and with fury poured out will I rule over you, and I will bring you out from the people, and I will gather you out of the countries wherein ye are scattered, with a mighty hand and with a stretched out arm and with fury poured out. And I will bring you into the wilderness of people, and there will I plead with you face to face, like as I pleaded with your fathers in the wilderness of the land of Mitzrayim. So will I plead with you, says Adonai Yahuah, and I will cause you to pass under the rod, and I will bring you into the bond of the covenant. And I will purge out from you among the rebels and them that transgress against me. I will bring them forth out of the country where they sojourn. And they shall not enter into the land of Yashar'el. And they shall know that I am Yahuwah. It says, with a mighty hand and a stretched out arm and fury with Yahusha, His righteousness, His stretched out arm that is bringing fury and judgment to this earth, Yahuah will gather His remnant from where He has scattered them and will lead them on the second Exodus journey to our Yeshua, our salvation, renewed Jerusalem, the new holy city. All right, you guys got to give me just one moment. All right, on to lines 7 through 9. Isaiah 56, 7 through 9. Even them will I bring to my holy mountain and make them joyful in my house of prayer. Their ascending smoke offerings and their sacrifices shall be accepted upon my altar, for my house shall be called the house of prayer for all people. Adonai Yahuah, which gathers the outcasts of Yashar'el, says, Yet I will gather others to Him besides those that are gathered unto Him. All ye beasts of the field, come to devour, yea, all ye beasts in the forest. Line 7 says, Even them will I bring to my holy mountain and make them joyful in my house of prayer. Their ascending smoke offerings and their sacrifices shall be accepted upon my altar, for my house shall be called a house of prayer for all people. Yahuah will bring us to His holy mountain on the top of Zion, and He will make our hearts Leap with joy as we enter into his house of prayer. We praise him and we weep at his feet and we bring supplications to the altar. Line 8, Isaiah 56:8. Adonai Yahuah, which gathers the outcasts of Yashar'el, says, yet will I gather others to him, besides those that are gathered unto him. The outcasts of Yashar'el, the lost sheep, those who haven't been called his people. He will... Oh my goodness, excuse me, you guys. He will gather us one day, which I believe is coming very soon, to... back to our shepherd, and he will take us to a pasture that is fat, and we will be overwhelmed with joy and happiness. John 10, lines 11 through 16 says, I am the good shepherd. The good shepherd gives his life for the sheep. But he that is a hireling and not the shepherd, whose own sheep are not, sees the wolf coming and leaves the sheep and flees. And the wolf catches them and scatters the sheep. The hireling flees because he is a hireling and cares not for the sheep. I am the good shepherd and know my sheep and am known of mine. As the Father knows me, even so I know the Father. And I lay down my life for the sheep. And the other sheep I have, which are not of this fold, them also I must bring, and they shall hear my voice, and there shall be one fold and one shepherd. Yahusha is the good shepherd, the one who came and taught the Torah correctly, the one who left us a perfect example to follow, the one who gave his life to save ours, to bring us back into covenant with Yahuah, so that we may live and not die in everlasting torment. Line 9 says, all ye beasts of the field, come to devour. Yea, all ye beasts in the forest. So, the end of line 8 said, I will gather the others to him, besides those that are gathered to him. And this is also speaking here, too, about the wolves that will come and try to catch the sheep and scatter them. This is Satan and his followers pursuing us on our second Exodus journey back to the promised land. Jeremiah 12:9, my heritage is unto me as a speckled bird. The birds round about are against her. Come ye, assemble all the beasts of the field, come to devour. Yahuwah's heritage, Yashar'el, is to him as a speckled bird, a rare bird, a precious bird. And all the other birds round about are against her, trying to kill her and devour her. Okay, finally we are on to lines 10 through 12. Isaiah 56:10-12 says, His watchmen are blind. They are all ignorant. They are all dumb dogs. They cannot bark, sleeping, lying down, loving to slumber. Yea, they are greedy dogs, which can never have enough. And they are shepherds that cannot understand. They all look to their own way, everyone for his own gain, from his quarter. Come ye, say they, I will fetch wine, and we will fill ourselves with strong drink, and tomorrow shall be as the day, and much more abundant. Line 10 says, his watchmen are blind, they are all ignorant, they are all dumb dogs, they cannot bark, sleeping, lying down, loving to slumber. This is speaking about the elders, our teachers, those who were supposed to be watchmen. They are ignorant and asleep. They are greedy shepherds that cannot understand good doctrine. Everyone only worries about himself and his own selfish gain. They are drunken, and they do this continually, day after day. We shouldn't remain sleeping, brothers and sisters. We shouldn't be willfully ignorant to the word and the commandments. Proverbs 20, line 13. Love not sleep, lest ye come to poverty. Open your eyes, and you shall be satisfied with bread. Open your spiritual eyes and ears, and be satisfied with the bread of life, with the word. And what does it mean to be asleep? Well, let's look at Proverbs 19, lines 15 through 16. It says, slothfulness casts into a deep sleep. An idle soul shall suffer hunger. He that guards the commandment guards his own soul, but he that despises his ways shall die. So, slothfulness, being slow to fulfill your end of the bargain, being lukewarm, being idle, unsure of what you believe, that causes the spirit of slumber to come over you, to close your spiritual eyes and ears. ears, so you don't hear or understand. And Yahuah does all these things. Isaiah 29, lines 9 through 10 says, "Stay yourselves and wonder. Cry ye out and cry. They are drunken, but not with wine. They stagger, but not with strong drink. For Yahuwah has poured out the ruach of deep sleep. Has poured out upon you the ruach of deep sleep, and has closed your eyes. The prophets and your rulers, the seers, has he covered. Wonder and cry out, the people of Yashar'el. The people are drunken, but not with wine. They stagger, but not with strong drink, but with the ruach of deep sleep that has been poured out upon these idle, lukewarm people, and non-believers alike, those who flat out reject his existence and his word altogether." Line 11, Isaiah 56:11, "Yea, they are greedy dogs, which can never have enough, and they are shepherds that cannot understand. They all look to their own way, everyone for his gain from his quarter." And just like we talked about above, the elders began to err. They created their own man-made traditions and doctrines and were out for their own gain, and they serve themselves, not Yahuah. Ezekiel 13, lines 1 through 13, "And the word of Yahuah came unto me, saying, Son of Adam, prophesy against the prophets of Yashar'el that prophesy, and say unto them that prophesy out of their own hearts." That's a lot of prophesying. "Hear ye the word of Yahuah. Thus says Adonai Yahuah, Woe unto the foolish prophets that follow their own ruach and have seen nothing. O Yashar'el, your prophets are like the foxes in the deserts. Ye have not gone up into the gaps, neither made up the hedge for the house of Yashar'el to stand in the battle of the day of Yahuah. They have seen vanity and lying divination, saying, Yahuah says, and Yahuah has not sent them. And they have made others to hope that they would confirm the word. Have ye not seen a vain vision? And have ye not spoken in a lying divination? Whereas ye say, Yahuah says it, albeit I have not spoken. Therefore, thus says Adonai Yahuah, because ye have spoken vanity and seen lies, therefore, behold, I am against you, says Adonai Yahuah, and my hand shall be upon the prophets that see vanity and that divine lies. They shall not be in the assembly of my people, neither shall they be written in the house of Yashar'el, neither shall they enter into the land of Yashar'el. And ye shall know that I am Adonai Yahuah, because they have seduced my people, saying, Peace, and there was no peace. And one built upon a wall, and lo, others daubed it with untempered mortar, and saying unto them which daub it with untempered mortar, that it shall fall. There shall be an overflowing shower, and ye, O great hailstone, shall fall, and a stormy wind shall rend it. Lo, the daubing wherewith ye have daubed it. Therefore, thus says Adonai Yahuah, I will even rend it with a stormy wind in my fury, and there shall be an overflowing shower in my anger, and great hailstones in my fury to consume it. So, does this not sound like what we just read earlier in Jubilees 26? It is very similar to what that says. Satan has also sent many of his prophets out into the world that showed their signs and wonders with their dark magic, with divination and enchantments. And Satan is very quick and eager to show humans signs and wonders because he knows that it's what our fleshly minds desire. He knows that we desire proof. Human minds seek proof, physical, tangible proof, and he preys on that. No one wants to steal your soul more than Satan. Nobody in this world is out to get you more than Satan is. Nobody is out to deceive you more. Nobody is out to lie to you more, and nobody wants you dead more than Satan does. Where was I? So, it's why the Israelites wanted a king. You know, they didn't want to hear Yahuwah's word from him or from Moses or Aaron. They wanted a king to lead them. And that isn't to say that Yahuwah doesn't still show his signs to his servants, but just be aware of what you see. Always test it to the word and pray on it, because following Satan and his wonders will get the curses put upon you, and Yahuah will hear your voice no longer. Proverbs 28:9, he that turns his ear away from hearing the Torah, even his prayer shall be an abomination. This is something to deeply consider, brothers and sisters. When we turn our ear away from hearing the Torah and depart to the right or to the left, when we entertain the world and the signs of Satan, even our prayers become an abomination. Now I want to read something that further touches on the understanding, on understanding with the heart and obtaining Yahuwah's wisdom. Let's read Wisdom of Solomon chapter 1. Hold on. Let me go ahead and open up my Bible, because it was way too much to type out. I was not typing all of that. Hold on, you guys. Alright, chapter 1. Alright, Wisdom of Solomon, chapter 1. Like I said earlier, not to be confused with the Song of Solomon, the Wisdom of Solomon is found in the Apocrypha. So, chapter 1 says, love righteousness, ye that be judges of the earth. Think of Yahuwah with a good heart, and in simplicity of the heart seek him. For he will be found of them that tempt him not, and shows himself unto such as do not distrust him. For froward thoughts separate from Elohim and his power, when it is tried, reproves the unwise. For into a malicious soul wisdom shall not enter, nor dwell in the body that is subject unto sin. For the Ruach HaKodesh of discipline will flee deceit and remove thoughts that are without understanding, and will not abide when unrighteousness comes in. For wisdom is a loving ruach, and will not acquit a blasphemer of his words. For Elohim is a witness of his mind, and a true beholder of his heart, and a hearer of his tongue. For the ruach Yahuwah fills the world, and that which contains all things has knowledge of the voice. Therefore he that speaks unrighteous things cannot be hid, neither shall vengeance when it punishes pass by him. For inquisition shall be made into the counsels of wicked men, and the sound of his words shall come unto Yahuwah for the manifestation of his wicked deeds. For the ear of jealousy hears all things, and the noise of murmurings is not hidden. Therefore beware of murmuring, which is unprofitable, and refrain your tongue from backbiting. For there is no word so secret that shall go for naught, and the mouth that believes And the mouth that bellies slays the soul. Seek not death in the error of your life, and pull not upon yourselves destruction with the works of your hands. For Elohim made not death, neither has he pleasure in the destruction of the living. For he created all things that they might have their being, and the generations of the world were healthful, and that there is no poison of destruction in them, nor the kingdom of death upon the earth. For righteousness is immortal, but wicked men with their works and words called it to them. For when they thought to have it, For righteousness is immortal, but wicked men with their works and words called it to them. For when they thought to have it their friend, they consumed to naught and cut a covenant with it, because they are worthy to take part with it. So, okay. Where was I? So, and then also, yeah, let's think about the crucifixion account. They didn't release Barabbas and crucify Yahusha because Barabbas was some just man. He was a robber. They released him because they hated Yahusha and they hated his word. So let's go ahead and read the crucifixion really quick. Matthew 27, lines 21 through 27. The governor answered and said unto them, whether of the two will ye that I release unto you? And they said, Barabbas. Pilate said unto them, what shall I do then with Yahusha, which is called Mashiach? And they all said unto him, let him be crucified. And the governor said, why? What evil has he done? But they cried out the more, saying, let him be crucified. And when Pilate saw that he could not prevail nothing, but rather a tumult was made, he took water and washed his hands before the multitude, saying, I am innocent of the blood of this just person. See ye to it. Then answered all the people and said, his blood be on us and our children. And then he released Barabbas unto them, and when he had scourged Yahusha, he delivered him to be crucified. So, all right, line 12. Lastly, line 12. Isaiah 56:12 says, "Come ye, say they, I will fetch wine, and we will fill ourselves with strong drink, and tomorrow shall be as this day, and much more abundant." So let's look at Isaiah 5:11. It says, "Woe unto them that rise up early in the morning, that they may follow strong drink, that continue until night, till the wine inflame them." So it's woe unto the drunkards. The wrath will be upon you, and the curses. It's not good to get drunk. It causes us to lose our way. Hosea 4:11, whoredom and wine and new wine, it take away the heart. So without the heart, we can't have understanding. We understand with our hearts, brothers and sisters, not just our minds. Proverbs 10:8, the wise in heart will receive commandments, but a prating fool shall fall. And 1 Kings 3, line 9, "Give therefore your servant an understanding heart to judge your people, that I may discern between good and bad. For who is able to judge this, your so great a people?" When we learn His Torah, when we learn His commandments and His judgments and His ordinances, and we do them, Yahuah sends His Spirit on us, the Ruach HaKodesh, the Spirit. And through His Spirit, He leads us in His wisdom, in His understanding. The unknown becomes the known. The misunderstood becomes understood. He makes everything clear, and He takes off those rose-colored glasses they've given everyone to wear. So come back to Him, brothers and sisters. Seek Him with all of your heart. Meditate in His Torah day and night. Lay His commandments upon your heart. And most importantly, do them. Do His commandments. Walk out our Father's righteousness. He who does righteousness is righteous, even as He is righteous. 1 John 3:7. So we ought to walk even so as He walked, my brothers and sisters. We must mimic Yahusha in every way. And that wraps up this week's message, brothers and sisters. So let's go ahead and close up with a prayer. Yahuah, thank you for allowing me to lead this study, to piece together your truth line by line, to delight in how marvelous your word is. Yahuah, I pray you send your Ruach upon my viewers. Open their spiritual eyes and ears. Allow them to hear and understand your word. We pray that this wickedness in this world doesn't continue much longer. We pray for your salvation to come, Yahuah. We pray for that great day, to be united by one Ruach, your Ruach, for eternity. How amazing that day is going to be. Until then, guard us, Yahuah. Protect us in the wrath that is to come. And in Yahusha's name we pray. Amen. All right, brothers and sisters, if you're sticking with me for the Torah portion, I will see you there. If not, I will see you again next week. Enjoy the rest of your Shabbat and Shalom.